Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Let's Get Ready, Planning Together for Emergencies. My name is Holly Nett and I'm the Community Resilience Manager on the Emergency Preparedness Team at Child Care Aware of America. Thank you for your interest in this topic. We're excited to have the expertise of Tara Forth from Sesame Street and Communities on this webinar. It's been a pleasure to work with her in preparing this webinar for all of you. Child Care Aware of America would also like to give a special thanks to our webinar partner, the National Association for Family Child Care, NAFCC. Today's webinar is part of a spring and summer webinar series focused on child care disaster preparation, response, and recovery topics. Next month, we'll be hosting a special webinar titled Child Care Emergency Supply Kits, What to Pack and Where It's At. Registration links for our webinars can be found at www.childcareprepare.org. You can also find several archived webinars from this spring and last fall at our website. The Emergency Preparedness Team at Child Care Aware of America has a large number of tools and resources related to preparedness, response, and recovery on our webpage. You can find our information at www.childcareprepare.org. We invite you to visit the site to sign up for a Child Care Emergency Preparedness listserv, which will allow you to receive updates and notifications on new resources that become available for the child care industry. Without further ado, I'd like to pass this webinar over to Tara Forth. Thanks for joining us today, Tara.
Thanks so much, Holly, for having me. And thank you everyone for joining us today. As Holly said, my name is Tara, and I am the Professional Development Manager here in the U.S. Social Impact Department at Sesame Workshop. So what we do in the U.S. Social Impact Department is really to create resources for the most vulnerable kids and families, and also the providers like you who work with them on a day-to-day basis. So we create free resources both in English and Spanish to support you in your very important work. And all of the resources that we do create can be found on sesamestreetincommunities.org. And all the resources that we'll cover today can be found and accessed there for use in your work. So today's topic is handling emergencies, which is an important topic for providers of all kinds. It's so crucial to be prepared for emergencies or natural disasters before they happen, and it's also important to offer comfort and consolation afterwards, especially to our littlest community members who often don't fully understand what's happened. In today's webinar, we'll define broadly what an emergency is, we'll walk through some childcare-specific considerations, and explore resources to help you prepare for emergencies, and offer strategies to help kids feel safe and secure after an emergency or during uncertain times. So what is an emergency? There are many nuances to the definition of an emergency, of course. We often think of an emergency as something that happens that we do not expect, and we have to act quickly to stay safe. Our friend Andy Rozak from Child Care Aware of America actually told me this following thing, basically that emergencies will be different for different people because an emergency can also be a situation that really just overwhelms our capacity to deal with it or remedy it, big or small. So for instance, so if a child falls and gets cut and maybe that cut starts bleeding or maybe twists an ankle, that situation can be an emergency for some, while others may have the skills to help with the situation. So an emergency really can vary based on our skill set. Let's look at a few examples. So of course, injury, as I just mentioned. Also, weather events can be emergencies, tornadoes, fire, floods. Other things that aren't necessarily emergency situations like a weather event, but could be a simple power outage for any reason. Maybe there's just a power line that's down. That could be an emergency if you don't have the ability to communicate. Obstructed roadways could also hinder parents from picking up their children or dropping off their children. So those are things to keep in mind as well. Parental separation is something to keep in mind and to really have a plan for reunification and for having a safe person to come pick them up. So these are just different things to think about that you might not consider when you initially think of what an emergency is. The important thing to remember is that we can get ready for emergencies, big and small, together. So in just a little bit, I'm going to walk through some resources that we've created here at Sesame Street that can help you engage kids and their families in your program's emergency preparedness planning. As we begin, let's talk about some specific things that child care providers can consider when thinking about emergency preparedness. It's of course really important to talk about emergency preparedness and response, especially when it comes to family child care centers or maybe an early Head Start center, because you are such a vital part of your community. And getting you back to work after a situation or an emergency helps families get back to work. And it's really a trickle-down effect to helping communities recuperate after a disaster. We know that childcare or lack of childcare after a disaster is one of the biggest setbacks to getting communities up and running. So it's really important for your programs to have a comprehensive emergency plan. So just keep in mind that you guys are so important, and that's why we're talking about this today. Here are a couple considerations that you can actually find on childcareprepare.org. Tom Copeland worked with Child Care Aware to come up with these five things that are, six things, sorry, that are really important to specifically family child care environments, but can be, of course, applied to other child care settings. So first, we want to have the correct insurance coverage. We hear these stories all the time that we think we have coverage, but there is some stipulation we weren't clear on. So it's really important to have a clear understanding of your insurance coverage. And on this website, they even have a PDF called How Insurance Protects You in an Emergency, which I recommend reading through. The next step is to have an emergency fund. This is pretty common sense, and most of us do this, hopefully, for ourselves. But we need to consider building up an emergency fund specifically for our childcare programs, especially if you are a family childcare provider and you fund most of your business out of pocket. The third thing we want to do is have a household or a classroom inventory. And this kind of goes along with insurance coverage. I know, for instance, if you have renter's insurance, it's a good idea to take pictures of your assets or even take a video of your space to just have that on hand as proof of what you own and what you can claim. And this will save you a lot of brain space. If you just have this on hand ready to go, this is something you don't want to be racking your brain to think of in the midst of so much change if you are dealing with a disaster situation like a flood or a fire where things have been damaged or destroyed or lost. So you definitely want to have this on hand. And what we like to point out is that making a household or a classroom inventory is something that you can actually get kids involved with helping you. And you can actually make it a language lesson. So you might have heard of doing a vocabulary walk, where you walk around in nature and you point out different things that you see. You could actually do this in your own childcare space. You could have each child write down the items they use on a daily basis or the things they keep in their cubbies. You could have them draw pictures if they aren't writing words yet, and you could help them write the words. And you could also do that same walk and talk activity. As you're walking around the room, you can be taking inventory, but asking kids what they see and having conversations about that. So you can really turn this preparedness strategy into a learning moment for kids as well. The fourth thing is that we recommend you keep your records in a safe place. Many of you might have a Go book or a Go box with important contact information or details for your kids and your program. It's also a really good idea to have a digital backup, either on a hard drive or somewhere in the cloud. in a service like Google Drive. And you want to remember that emergencies take many forms. So if you have this Go box, you don't necessarily only want it in physical form because you might not be able to access it and grab it quickly. So having duplicates really does keep you prepared. The fifth thing is to leverage your network. So if you are a family child care provider, this might be asking, do you have someone who could cover for you if you're not feeling well or if you have a personal emergency? Do you know other child care providers in your area who can lend an extra hand if one of your staff members is unavailable? And I know it's a hard thing to think about, but especially if you're running a home-based program, you have to think about if something were to happen to you and how would you take care of the kids and keep that care consistent or have a transition plan. And if you're in a center, of course, there are protocols with if you have a sick day or something happens to you, but making sure that the things that you do day in and day out are documented so that they're able to live on if you have to be away for a time. And think about leveraging your network also in the parents and the community around you. So you don't have to do everything by yourself. You should know your community helpers, which we'll talk about. And you can leverage those people and resources in the event of an emergency before and after. And finally, we want to have clear parent and staff policies. So have your emergency plans in writing. You need to articulate them to parents and any staff you may have. And you want to make sure that everyone is clear on what to do and who to call, et cetera. So a lot of times we see that we have emergency plans written somewhere, but they're not explained or practiced nearly regularly enough with staff or parents or kids, of course. So make sure that everyone is really familiar with those protocols, and I would schedule regular practices, not to scare kids, obviously, but just to be prepared because we know routines need to be repeated for things to really lock in place for kiddos. So let's get ready together. It is important to have a comprehensive emergency preparedness plan in place for our program. So we are going to talk about a few resources to engage kids and families to become emergency ready. Like I said at the beginning, all of these resources can be found on sesamestreetincommunities.org. This is a website that has more than 800 activities. It's growing every month. These are free resources for kids, parents, and providers. You can actually log in as a parent or caregiver or as a provider and get access to additional resources, including some professional development resources. Everything is available in English and Spanish. You have the option to log in, create an account, and if you log in, you will receive monthly updates on what's new and some tips and tricks for how to use this media in your settings. So please visit sesamestreetincommunities.org. You can use it on your cell phone or on your tablet even, and really share it with parents as well. So let's explore. So when you go to the website, you can go to a variety of topic pages. We have, I think, over 20 topics at this point. Today, we're going to focus mostly on our handling emergencies topic page. You'll find so many resources to help you prepare. And from a content perspective, most of these resources are focused around five strategies that kids and families and providers can use to get ready. The first one is we want kids to learn whole names. So kids should know their whole names and their parents' whole names and your whole name as well if you are taking care of them on a regular basis. It's so funny how many times kids don't even know that mom has a different name or dad has a different name. They just know them as mom and dad. So it is important to learn whole names. And this is very important, especially for reunification, which is such a big hindrance to getting communities back up and running. The second thing that these resources address is practicing addresses and phone numbers. My mom, when I was growing up, did a really good job of this to learn my phone number. The ending of the number was 8221. And she said, you can make it sound like a train, like a choo-choo train. So I would say 8221 and pump my fists like I was chugging a train. So we can do fun things like this to help kids remember and have little cheat sheets in their brains about those numbers. And you can also have them practice dialing the number on a phone and writing down their address, of course, or just saying their address. The third thing is that we want to point out special helpers. And this includes things like knowing where police stations are or fire stations are. Many communities have safe haven spots or safe spaces for kids. Maybe they can go into a gas station and they have a decal on the door that indicates this is a safe space. If you need help from a grown-up, we will get you help or shelter, anything like that. So make kids aware of those safe spaces and parents also, so that they can articulate this information to their children at home as well. This also might mean, if you're a family child care provider or home-based center, getting to know your neighbors, getting to know who people are, being on a first name basis, knowing how they can help you in different situations and how you can help them, and really building that community around your program. The fourth and fifth things, of course, are make an emergency plan, an emergency kit. And I know as child care providers that you have specific rules and specifications that you need to have prepared for your program. So definitely follow those rules first. But these last two EPREP kits tips is that kids should be familiar with the emergency plan and the kit, just like we talked about. And we need to help them understand why they'd use this kit, or that they might never need it, but it's there just in case. So it's not a scary thing, it's a familiar thing that we practice and we repeat this exposure to through our routines. So let's take a look at some of the resources that support these five strategies that we just talked about. This first one is a video that features Rosita and Grover, and Rosita is singing about knowing her first and last name.
What are you doing?
I'm getting ready for an emergency.
Looks like you're playing the guitar to me.
I am. I'm practicing a special song about my first and last name. It's really, really important to know them in an emergency.
Oh, I know. Because sometimes you are not with your mommy or daddy, or even babysitter. If you know your whole name, people can help your family find you.
See, Grover.
But how did your song help you remember your first and last name?
Like this. Oh, my first name is Rosita. I'll sing it loud. Oh, my last name's Bella Cuevas.
Bella Cuevas?
Hey, and it makes me proud. I'm Rosita Bella Cuevas. Now I bet that's a name you'll never forget. Now it's your turn. Oh, your first name, Alexia.
Grover.
Amanda. You'll sing it loud.
Anna.
Beth.
Sabrina.
Oh, your last name is
Rodriguez.
Water!
Lopez!
It makes you proud!
Jacob! Amanda! Sam.
Colin.
Murphy.
Rivera.
And it makes you proud. Candy will be sure will go.
So that video is so catchy. The song is really catchy, and it's all about learning whole names. I, again, particularly love when Grover says that he's so surprised that Mommy and Daddy have whole names too. In addition to this video, we also have worksheets to help kids learn their address and phone number. And these worksheets are great to send home with families, so that parents can post them on their refrigerator, and you can keep a copy, and they can keep a copy in their emergency kit as well. So let's take a look at a couple of other resources. So this first one is about practicing addresses and phone numbers, which we already said is so important. So on this worksheet, it's a printable that you can download, of course, for free on Sesame Street and Communities. Is all about knowing your address. So you can draw a picture of your home here. You can help kids write the address on the line below. You can also have kids practice their phone number. So you can write the phone number on the line for them or help them write their numbers. And then you could have them actually dial the numbers, you know, on their with their finger on this piece of paper. You could also make an enlarged version of a keypad and have them practice, or you could have them practice on a real phone. We know how tech savvy kids are these days. So having them access a smartphone and just seeing how that works in case of an emergency is really important as well. You can talk about dialing 911 as well when an emergency is happening and there's no other person to help. And you can pretend by asking questions such as, you know, 911, what's your emergency and what's your address? So really have that role playing to help reinforce these important details for kids and have them feel comfortable answering those questions. Another resource that we have is about pointing out your special community helpers. And we talked about identifying fire stations or police stations or hospitals, even maybe a local clinic, and maybe a school in your neighborhood. And this is a printable that is fun to do for kids. So they can color in these spots, they can go through the street, and you can talk about what each of these helpers does. You could also adapt this to fit your neighborhood or your community and take pictures of those places in your community. Maybe you put a larger version on your wall in a classroom, or have make your own printable even. And you can highlight the community helpers that are very specific to your setting and your community. You can have kids describe these helpers in their own words. And you could even take walks to explore or meet these community helpers on your map. Maybe have a community helper scavenger hunt. And I do know that many places like fire stations offer tours or to kids and groups and families, and or maybe we'll even come to your setting. So maybe they'll come to your school or to park in front of your house if you're a family child care provider. And it's always so fun and fascinating for kids to see how the sirens work, how they go down the fire pole, how they put on all their heavy gear, and what it all does to keep them safe and sound. Let's look at another resource. So the two things we talked about were making an emergency preparation plan and making an emergency kit. This one is about making an emergency preparation plan. So on the right, you'll see some handouts, which are for families, great for families. You can make one of these for your program or your school as well. And you can indicate, you know, this is the Rodriguez family's emergency plan. It's got important contact information. It's got places to meet, safe places, safe numbers to call. And you can have this available in your Go kit or your emergency prep kit, and parents can have a copy as well. So it's really good, maybe if you want to fill this out with the family and make sure you both have copies and you both understand what you all will do in an emergency situation. And then on the left, this is part of this, it's a workshop for childcare providers. So you can go through this. It has steps for you to talk about emergencies with children and how to make a plan and how to connect with parents. So this has some really go-to strategies that you can leverage in your program and definitely take advantage of that. The next thing is about making an emergency kit. And here is a checklist. It's a printable checklist of items to pack in your emergency kit. You can customize this, of course, to fit your setting, and you can also encourage parents to make an emergency kit at home. If you do have the opportunity to work closely with parents and families, you could even host a kit making workshop, and this would be an excellent way to level up parent knowledge and engagement and make sure that everybody knows each other, even build some community within your program and make sure that everyone's on the same page about what's important to be ready for an emergency. So we've talked about preparing for an emergency, but we also want to keep in mind that it's important to offer kids comfort and support after an emergency or during a difficult or uncertain time. So I'm just briefly going to walk through the Sesame approach for difficult times and then talk about a few resources that support this approach. So when we create content around difficult times and tough conversations, we aim to do a couple of things. So we want to present a child's perspective. So often we know that a small voice of a child is lost in the chaos of a difficult situation, and that could be an emergency. That could also be something like a big transition, maybe a divorce or the loss of a loved one. And when grown-ups are going through these difficult things, it can be really hard to remember that children are experiencing things so much differently. It's really important for caring grown-ups to contextualize these big events to make them less scary and less unknown. So we want to give providers and parents language to and modeling to help them do that. So we're presenting a child's perspective in the resources that we create. The second thing we want to do is try to identify simple moments or strategies that can make a big difference. In uncertain times, we as grown-ups can be tempted to try to fix everything all at once or make big changes to make everything better. But we know what works better is to make small, consistent steps to help. So we often try to prompt parents or caregivers to think about the simplest change that they can make to help their families towards our larger goal. So we ask that to ourselves when we create content, and we want providers and educators like you to do the same. Really look for the simple moments that make a big difference. We also want to make sure that parents take care of themselves. Parents and providers, you all do so much for kids, and in these uncertain times, it's really, really important for you to take care of yourself, to know where your emotions are coming from, where your stressors are, and to help calm yourself down so that you can be a real pillar of strength and comfort for kids. So we do emphasize a lot of self-care during times of transition or times of emergency situations or in the aftermath of an emergency. And that's not always easy. We recognize that, but even taking deep breaths, finding a quiet moment to yourself can be a really good thing to just recenter so that you can really serve the kids and families that you work with. And then the final thing is that we often try to identify the overarching feeling that might be blocking families from asking or getting the help they need. We want to take a big picture perspective because we know that big feelings are coming from all sides. So kids are having big feelings, parents are, we as providers are having big feelings. And so it's important for us to get that big picture and understand and recognize that there's a lot coming, there's a lot happening, and just to be mindful of that and very aware. So as providers, it's important for us to sort of take a step back, take things too personally if people come off harsh or impatient or just frazzled, because there's a lot going on. We have a clip here on Sesame Street in Communities. Actually, there's a full episode from Sesame Street, and it's all about Big Bird as he actually gets his nest destroyed in a hurricane that comes through Sesame Street. So I encourage you to watch the full clip. There's one scene in particular that supports the strategies I just talked about from a content perspective. You'll notice in this scene that Big Bird keeps repeating, "My nest, my home." He's a little bit frozen. He's having a difficult time articulating what he's feeling. He just keeps repeating, "My nest and my home." And often kids will be in a state of shock or just uncertainty, not sure how to articulate their feelings, not sure how to talk about what happened. And so we really see that from Big Bird. And of course, his community on Sesame Street supports him by giving him a place to stay in the meantime and taking the time to help him put his nest back together. But they also articulate that it's gonna take a while for him to get back to how things sort of were before. And so another thing that's great in this clip is that Gordon and his wife Susan, who is Big Bird, is staying with them, they offer help in very simple ways. They actually just offer him snacks. They offer him quiet time. They give him crayons and paper so that he can draw and color about his feelings. And then they just talk with him and listen. And so these are very simple ways to offer comfort, but they're really strong and they make a big difference in Big Bird's perspective and understanding of what has happened, and that things might not be exactly the same as before, but that eventually things will be okay. And so I encourage you to watch that clip on your own time. It's actually the full episode. It's very moving. And think about ways that you can apply those comfort strategies to your own setting. And then the next resource I want to show is a guide. It's a family guide that is particularly great for parents, but you can use it as well, called Here for Each Other. And this is a guide that helps grown-ups answer big questions in child-appropriate ways. This toolkit is full of activities that you can do to help kids talk about their emotions or try to establish some simple routines in times of uncertainty or transition. And this one is on SSIC, so it's on Sesame Street and Communities, but it's also available at sesamestreet.org/toolkits/emergencies. So you can look at it there as well and download that for free. So we want to give a few basic tips to help kids cope after emergencies. So you'll see these strategies in the Here for Each Other guide that I just mentioned. And these include that we want to give children the facts. So we know that children might still be confused about what exactly happened. We want to explain it in a child-friendly way. So if, for instance, a hurricane happened, we can explain that a hurricane is a big storm with a lot of wind and heavy rain. And it can be scary, but adults will do their best to help keep children safe. So again, that reassurance and giving them the facts in a bite-sized way. The second thing is, of course, we want to comfort children. We want to try to calm their fears. We want to keep them physically safe first, of course. And then we want to reassure them that what happened is not their fault in any way, and that we love them and we're going to do our best to take care of them. You can also, of course, give comforting touch. So you can give hugs, you can hold hands, you can maybe rub their back, any sort of calming gesture that they're comfortable with. The third thing is that we want to listen and talk to our children. So we want to follow their lead. They might not want to talk about their emotions and experiences right away. And if they prefer not to talk, we can play with them. We can spend time with them doing the things that they like to do. You know, you could maybe color together, sit and color a coloring sheet together. You don't necessarily have to be talking, but your attention and your presence is really comforting to them. If they do express an emotion like sadness, anger, or fear, you can reassure them that it's okay to feel this way, and you can encourage them to continue sharing their feelings with words or pictures. And remember that the littlest of our kids, they don't always have the vocabulary to express their emotions. So giving them new words might help them discover what they're feeling inside. We want to try to keep a normal routine, even if it's a very small routine, maybe a book at bedtime, or just telling a story if you don't have a book with you. Maybe it's a morning hug or an afternoon dance party. Things that you don't need materials for or things for, you can still do those happy things. We want to spend time with our children again, doing all the things I just mentioned. And we want to pay attention to signs of stress. So we do have some information, particularly around stress and the symptoms that you might want to look for. And they're available in our traumatic experiences topic page. There's a whole list based on age. And of course, every child is unique. So we want to keep that in mind, and not all of these signs necessarily mean the same thing, but we do want you to notice signs. And if you notice anything, you know, like continued or regressive behavior like bedwetting or nightmares or really clinging behavior that's very unusual for the child, you do want to talk to another provider, maybe a peer, another teacher, to see what they think. And then consult a school counselor or a mental health professional as you see fit. So we do definitely want to be delicate about that, but do pay attention because you know these kids so well. Other things we want to do are monitor media use. We know that a lot of things can be said on the news that are big and scary. So we want to limit that from kids, and we want to just really contextualize what's happening for children so that they don't hear something and not know how to interpret it. Then we want to empower kids. So if we've directly been affected by an emergency, kids can feel like they don't have any control. So helping them again maintain those routines, but also giving them responsibilities or ways to help rebuild in the community might give them a sense of empowerment and control, which is important. And then these last two really go hand in hand. We want you to take care of yourself as providers. We want you to surround yourself with a support system through relatives or friends, faith leaders, counselors. We want you to stay active, get rest when you can, eat as healthfully as possible. And when you do these things, you'll be able to stay a little bit more grounded, and that will help you offer a sense of hope to the kids that you care for. So we want you to take care of yourself so that you can really be a rock for the children and families you serve. There's just one last resource that I want to share with you, and it's called Helping Hands Workshop. And there are five things that your hands can help you remember so you can count on your fingers. And this is a workshop that goes through really talking through an exercise that's great to do with parents or your peers or just yourself as a good reminder of how much you care for kids. So you can use your hands and you can think about helping hands, hugs, hearts, here, and here. And these all align with simple things that you can remember to do in an emergency situation. So helping hands is remembering we're not alone, that there are always helpers. Hugs is about feeling safe and secure, right? Giving comfort. Hearts is about appreciating the power of kindness and compassion and showing empathy. Here is talking, listening, communicating, all those things we just went through. And then here, again, keeping those familiar routines and being present. So you can use your hand to sort of remember those five strategies that we just talked through. You can find that workshop in the offering comfort section of Sesame Street and Communities. So let's just quickly review the things that we've talked about today. We've learned that an emergency is something that happens that we do not expect, and we have to act quickly to stay safe. We learned that we can have a comprehensive preparedness plan that gets parents and kids involved in the process. And we learned that your comfort and care can make a big difference in a difficult situation and after a difficult situation. So you guys are so important. And I hope that these resources have helped you and will benefit your practice and your program. You can keep in touch with us by sending an email to communities@sesame.org. We have two Facebook groups that you can join. One is Sesame Street and Communities, and the other is a closed private group for providers only, Sesame Street Community Providers. And you can request access and we will let you in, and you can share what your emergency preparedness plan looks like for your program. And we'd love to hear from you. And thank you so much again, Holly and Child Care Aware of America and NASCC for letting us share these resources with you and for your continued partnership.
Thank you, Tara. We're so fortunate to have your expertise today, and Child Care Aware of America appreciates our partnership with Sesame Street as well. Sesame Street's created such wonderful user-friendly resources for children, families, and caregivers, so really appreciate your time today as well. If any of you have any questions at all, feel free to reach out to the Emergency Preparedness Team at Child Care Aware of America. You can reach out to us on our webpage, which again is www.childcareprepare.org, or you can also email us at preparedness@usa.childcareaware.org. We hope that you found this webinar today to be helpful. Thank you for your time.